Good evening. Ladies and gentlemen, on the heels of that amazing video, I have one question for you. Can you feel it? Can you sense the electricity in the air? You know, it's not a thunderstorm this time. It's not a hurricane. It's right here, right now, among all these authors that are here and all you book lovers out there. Welcome to the Savannah Book Festival. It's going to be an amazing year, and we're just getting started. Now, for those of you who were not here last night for our opening address with James Patterson, my name is Mark Murphy, and I'm the president of the Board of Directors of the Savannah Book Festival. And on behalf of that board and the more than 250 volunteers who help make this festival a reality every year, I'd like to welcome all of you to the second night of this season's festival presented by Georgia Power and the Sheehan Family Foundation. As the video said, it's our 10th anniversary year, and we're so glad to be sharing this landmark occasion with all of you. Tonight, we're delighted to have you here for our keynote address with Colson Whitehead, whose novel, The Underground Railroad, was the winner of this year's National Book Award. I'd like to particularly thank Alfie and Dee Dee Mays for their generous sponsorship of Mr. Whitehead tonight. It is folks like Dr. and Ms. Mays that make the magic happen, and tonight is going to be really magical. You know, this festival is unique in so many ways. First of all, it brings the book lovers together to get in a uniquely literary city, a town whose history tells its own story. Moreover, festival attendees can see and hear the many brilliant writers that are here, either for free or for the nominal ticketed prices that we have here in the events like this one. In addition, the hostess city of the South, that's one of Savannah's many nicknames, treats its authors like family. It all adds up to be a truly transcendent experience for everyone involved. We are all, indeed, fortunate to be here. It's an experience made possible through the incredible generosity of all of our many donors, volunteers, and literati members. Though I can't name you all should know that you're appreciated. Now, a couple of other shout-outs here. First, to the festival's executive director, Kim Bakiasuan, and her small but mighty team of obsessive compulsive overachievers. And that applause is well-deserved. They have worked tirelessly to make sure that all the myriad moving parts that remain in sync during the festival. I'd also like to thank the members of the Page Turners and the Landings Bookies Book Club for ushering all of you into your seats in this packed house tonight. A couple of housekeeping notes as we all thank, please applaud them as well. Thank you. So a couple of housekeeping notes that I decided to serve as an example of one last night. Please turn your cell phones off. Mine went off on stage yesterday next to Mr. Patterson. I swore I'd turn the thing off, and somehow it went off anyway. So please turn your cell phones off out of courtesy to everyone else. Please do not use flash photography. And for the question and answer portion, we ask that you raise your hand so that one of our volunteers can find you with a microphone. Finally, following the presentation, Mr. Whitehead will be signing festival purchase copies of his books. There will be numbered and a numbered signing card is provided by our booksellers from Ex Libris, which will preserve your place in line. Now, I'd like to introduce journalist Celeste Headley to the stage, who will introduce our author tonight. Many of you know Celeste from her radio program on Second Thought, which airs weekday mornings at 9 a.m. on Georgia Public Broadcasting. Festival attendees also know her as a great friend. Please join me in welcoming Celeste.
It's such a pleasure to introduce Colson Whitehead. He is such an important voice in the world. And the fact of the matter is there are a lot of people who write important books, a lot of them. But there are very few who write so beautifully with such a strong story and character that you forget you're reading something important. If I were to list all of his awards, we'd be here for the rest of the night. I'll list a few. A Whiting Writers Award, a Guggenheim Fellowship, a MacArthur Fellowship, the so-called Genius Grant. His latest work is called The Underground Railroad, and it imagines what the escape to freedom might have looked like and felt like in a parallel timeline. Not what happened, but what might have happened. And it makes you completely rethink a story that you think you know, and it still manages to be an incredibly good read. The Underground Railroad was Time Magazine's pick for Book of the Year. It was the number one Amazon Book of the Year and the 2016 National Book Award winner for fiction. He said that he is the kind of person who, quote, just likes being in my cave and thinking up weird stuff. But if you have read any of his six books, you know that weird stuff has the power to change the way we view the world and ourselves, and that is no small thing. We are so honored to have him here tonight. Please welcome Colson Whitehead.
Hey, howdy. Thanks to the Book Festival for having me and all you nice folks for coming out. I usually spend Friday nights at home weeping over my regrets, so this is a nice change of pace. My latest book has brought me to a new audience who may be unfamiliar with my work up to this point, so I thought maybe I'd start with just sort of sharing how I got started writing, my journey to this place, if you will, where I'm coming from and where I'm going. I hope you'll find parts of it entertaining and edifying. I'll start at the beginning. I was born a poor black child. I remember the days sitting on the porch with my family, singing and dancing down in Mississippi. Or maybe that was someone else. I was Steve Martin, a jerk. I was born and raised in Manhattan. I was a bit of a shut-in. I would have preferred to have been a sickly child, but it didn't work out that way. I always like it when you read a biography of someone like James Joyce, and it says, he was a sickly child and forced to retreat into a world of imagination. It always sounds so wonderful. Instead, I just didn't like going outside. Other kids left the house, did sports, played in the great outdoors. I like to stay inside watching The Twilight Zone and The Outer Limits. I read a lot of comic books and science fiction and Stephen King. It seemed like when I was in sixth grade that writing the X-Men or Spider-Man would be like the perfect job. If you were a writer, you could work from home. You didn't have to wear clothes or talk to people, and you could just make up stuff all day. So until I got to college and started reading different kinds of fiction, more contemporary stuff, highbrow stuff, I wanted to write The Black Shining or The Black Salem's Lot. Basically, if you took any Stephen King title and put the black in front of it, that's what I wanted to do. And then I started, you know, studying the modernists in college, and I like the equivalency I saw between science fiction and horror and, say, magic realism in Garcia Marquez, the absurd landscapes of Beckett, the mythical places of Borges. They played with the fantastic as much as any of the genre writers I enjoyed growing up. And I think it helps that from my first exposure to Samuel Beckett, I found him to be a form of high realism. A guy is buried up to his neck in sand and can't move. He has an itch on his leg, he can't scratch. That sounds like Monday morning to me. So I was in college and I considered myself a writer, but I didn't actually write anything, which apparently is part of the process. I wore black and smoked cigarettes, but never actually sat down and wrote. I finally composed two stories, two five-page epics that I used to audition for the creative writing classes, and I was turned down each time. I was very depressed, but looking back, it was great training for being a writer, because when you're a writer, everyone hates you and no one wants to read your stuff. And if you internalize that hatred and disdain early, you're ahead of the game. But I was very fortunate enough when I got out of college to get a job at the Village Voice, an alternative weekly in New York City. And you may know the Village Voice, or you may not be familiar with it. The thing you have to know about The Voice is that whenever you were there, it was at its height, and then when you left, it went downhill. So if you were there in the 50s, hanging out with Norman Mailer, writing about beatnik culture, that's when The Voice was at its height, and then you moved on and it declined. If you were there in the 70s, writing about the birth of punk and disco, that's when The Voice was incredible, and then you moved on. I was there from 91 to 96. We put out a great paper. It's too bad what happened to it once I started working there. But that's where I really sort of became a writer. It was a writer's paper, and if you could hit up one of the editors for a job, they'll give you a chance. So I was there for 6 months, and I hit up the TV editor. He seemed like an easy mark, and he gave me my first clip. It was a think piece about the season finales of the shows Growing Pain and Who's the Boss. So, you know, 25 years later, I think they stand up as the definitive takes on those two shows. And I used that clip to audition for other parts of the paper, and I was writing for a book section and a movie section. And I got confident enough to start working on my own fiction. And I was very self-conscious. I didn't want to do what everyone else is doing, the cliched, say, autobiographical first novel where you get back at everyone who wronged you when you were a child. I want to say that for my fourth novel, Sag Harbor. So I decided to write a book about a Gary Coleman-esque child star. In the book, he's a black kid adopted by a white family, a rich white family. And the show in the book is called I'm Movin' In, with apostrophe. Because in the 70s, you know, all the sitcoms were about the apostrophe, like Different Strokes, What's Happening, and it seemed like the apostrophe was a real sop to realism. So I wrote a book about this character, and I got an agent, and I was very excited. And then we started hearing back from people. So I, for one, was very surprised that a book about a Gary Coleman-esque child star would fail to find its place in the market. And the rejection slips began to accumulate, and I started to have some really bizarre thoughts. When I first became aware of Top 40 radio, it was during the late 70s, so that meant a lot of disco, the Bee Gees, Diana Ross, Donna Summer. And for years, I tried to understand what the song MacArthur Park is about. I grew up on the Donna Summer version. Perhaps some of you know the Richard Harris version with his Irish brogue. And I know some of you don't even know what the heck I'm talking about. So I brought an audio aid. The song poses an enigma. Who left the cake out in the rain and why? Was it some birthday cake, some childhood feud finally come to a head? It wasn't until I started getting all these rejection letters as I sat around my underwear watching Jerry Springer with the shades drawn that I finally got what the song MacArthur Park is about. MacArthur Park is an investigation of the artist's journey. I'd gone to a lot of trouble gathering ingredients. And when I was done, someone left my cake out in the rain. All the sweet green icing was flowing down. I didn't think that I could take it, frankly, because it took so long to bake it. And I would never, ever, ever have that recipe again. Knopf Publishing Group, why did you leave my cake out in the rain? Houghton Mifflin Publishing Group, why did you leave my cake out in the rain? Atlas Vanity Publishing of Secaucus, New Jersey, why did you not even return my phone calls? That was so weird. Maybe I wasn't cut out for this writing thing. I started thinking about what else I might be able to do. My parents were of that generation that if you're an able-bodied black person, it was your duty to make something of yourself, uplift the race, become a lawyer, an accountant, a doctor. Those professions weren't up my alley, so I tried to think about what else I might be able to do. And here I call your attention to my slender, delicate fingers and thin, feminine wrists. I bring them up not out of shame, but just to point out I'm not cut out for certain kinds of work. Instead of feeling shame nowadays, most ideally just feel sadness because we've just passed an important moment in our nation's history when a skinny black man with slender fingers and thin feminine wrists actually became president. If it was ever going to be our time, that was pretty much it, I think. But back to my hands. These are hands that say pianist, hand model, surgeon, were these professions I might be suited for. Could I play the piano? Well, let me tell you a little story. The first thing I bought when I got a decent paycheck was an ergonomic chair. I slouch, I can't type, and I hunt and peck. And when I was writing my first book, I had to pop Advil all day because my neck was all messed up from being hunched over. How could I sit at a piano bench without armrests, no lumbar support? I could not be a pianist. On paper, being a hand model must be the life. You get free watches, free hand cream, travel a lot, meet interesting people in the international jet set. But I had a very conservative upbringing. How could I indulge in the model lifestyle? I'd read stories about Kate Moss. This was the early 90s. So that was out. Finally, surgeon. I was all set to go to med school. Just head on down there and sign up, whatever you do. And then I heard how long operations are. You have to stand on your feet for like 10, 15, 20 hours straight. What if you have to go to the bathroom? I kept thinking about this. Half the reason I got into the writing business was so that I could sit on my ass all day. So I tried to break it down scientifically. The average book of literary fiction sells 5,000 copies. 5,000 copies, if you're lucky. Now, assuming that everyone loves this book, doesn't just throw it in the trash in disgust, and makes tons of other people read it who also love it, this book has 50,000 readers, 50,000 people who love it. Well, there are 6.5 billion people in the world. You've made an impact in the lives of 0.00000001% of the population. You're not a gnat trying to catch the attention of an elephant. You're a microbe in the butt of a gnat trying to catch the attention of an elephant. Now, I know there's some young people who want to be writers in the audience, so I don't want you to freak out. I just pulled the 5,000 number out of the air. I was trying to Google it before I got here, but I couldn't think of the right search words. I'm not supposed to use Google as much as I do, but at this point in human civilization, I sort of want Google for everything. I want to Google superego, like when I'm out drinking and think, maybe I'll have one more beer. The Google superego will go, did you mean go home right now? Or it's Sunday, and I'm like, oh, look, there's a 15-hour Project One Ray marathon on Bravo. I think I'll watch it. The Google superego will go, did you mean read a book and tell your family how much you love them? I think it'd be a total killer app. But where was I? The population of Earth, it's very intimidating. Well, what about life on other planets, you would naturally ask yourself next. Perhaps there is life on other planets, and they have a taste for language poetry, creative nonfiction, coming-of-age novels. Well, I hate to burst your bubble, but scientists say that the nearest planet outside our solar system is 10.5 light years away, which is pretty far. And the chance of one of our Earth scientists coming up with a faster-than-light drive in our lifetime is quite slim. Estimates about the possibility of life on other planets vary. Some say that only 1 in 100 million planets is capable of supporting life. And what's the chance they would like your crap anyway? They could be all about the haiku up there or something. So you're out of luck. And I got very depressed thinking about this. And then I thought, maybe it's out of my hands. Maybe I have no choice. A friend of mine is a real jerk. He has some fine qualities, but there's no escaping that he's a real jerk sometimes. And for years I wondered how he came to be such a jerk, and then it occurred to me, evolution. For generations, jerks have been breeding with other jerks to produce more jerks. who have litters of jerks in turn. It must have started thousands of years ago when some Neanderthal jerk got together with another Neanderthal jerk from the next cave over. Perhaps they met while fighting over a piece of saber-toothed meat and just clicked, started talking about the weather. Oh, Gluck Gluck, the thunder god, is quite angry today, don't you think? Yes, I agree, and you have lovely eyes. And it was pure chemistry, and they took it from there. And they had a child, and their jerk kid got together with another Neanderthal jerk kid, or Neanderthal of similar type, a moron or a douche. And and they had a kid who was half jerk, half douche, and so on for millennia, more or less breeding and concentrating negative qualities, herding all that negative DNA together until my friend was born. So I figure it's the same with writers. That artistic temperament must go back just as far. There's a Neanderthal who paused while beating in the skull of a Neanderthal from the next cave over, and he thought to himself, hunting and gathering, gathering and hunting. Is that all there is to this miserable life? And he was the first Neanderthal existentialist. And he found a Neanderthal of melancholy temperament, a Neanderthal female who liked to draw non-representational doodles on the cave wall, and she was the first abstract artist. And they had a child who didn't like to hunt or gather, but just tell stories all day. And he found a suitable mate and so on throughout the millennia, spawning moody, arty kids. In the 1600s, one villager says to another, hey, did you see that new puppet show last night? And the artistic villager says, no, I don't watch puppet shows. I don't even own a puppet show set. I only listen to NPR. And so on to the present day, that artistic DNA surviving and getting together. So as I sat in my dirty studio apartment, watching Jerry Springer surrounded by rejection slips, I realized that I was a recipient of all that sit on your ass, muse about crap all day DNA. And it didn't matter if no one liked what I was doing. I had no choice. So I got back to work, and it went better the next time. So. So time passes. I first had the idea for the Underground Railroad about almost 17 years ago. I was sitting on my couch and came across a reference to it. I remembered how when I was in the fourth grade and my teacher started explaining it to me, I envisioned a literal subway beneath the earth because I was from New York and that made sense. And then she explained that that was very impractical and that's not how it worked. But I thought, as I came across this reference 16 years ago, wouldn't it be weird if I wrote a book about that? That'd be a weird premise to start with. And then I added the element of the book where each state that our protagonist Cora goes through is a different state of American possibility, sort of like Gulliver's Travels. And that seemed like a really great idea. And I knew if I did it back then, I would have screwed it up. I was sort of a Gen X slacker, douchey kind of guy. And I thought if I wrote more books, I might become a better writer. If I was a little older, had more experiences, I might bring that worldly experience to the book. And I might be able to do the idea justice. And so each time I finished a book, I would pull out my notes and think, am I ready now? And the answer is always no. And until about 3 years ago, I had an idea for a book and sold it to my editor. But I was still having some doubts, so I decided to tell my wife about the idea for this Underground Railroad idea story. And she said, she's a very good listener. You know, sometimes in a marriage, you have to make conversation to kill the silences, and she's always there for me when that happens. And I told her the idea, and she said, honey, I don't want to say that your idea about a Brooklyn writer going through a midlife crisis is dumb, per se, but this Underground Railroad book sounds pretty good. So I was like, huh. So next couple days, I called my agent, and told her the idea, and she's always very helpful. And she just said both ideas are good, which was not very helpful. But then she emailed me on a Sunday and said, I can't stop thinking about that Underground Railroad idea. So I was like, huh. So Wednesday was shrink day, so I told my shrink, and she just said, what, are you crazy? I mean, we both know you're crazy, but I think this idea would be a very good thing to work on. So that was three. I had to tell my editor and break the ice with him, and he just said, giddy up, motherfucker, which is old school publishing talk for, that's a very compelling idea, and let's pursue it. So I did. This section isn't from an early part of the book. It's old Jockey's birthday. He's the oldest slave on the plantation, and whenever he feels a need for relief, he declares, this is my birthday, and it could be once a year, twice a year, and they have music and food, and it's a brief celebration. Our protagonist is Cora. She's 16 or 17. She doesn't know how old she is. A lot of slave masters didn't keep track of how old their property were. Why would you keep track of how old your hammer is? It's a tool and an object, so she doesn't know how old she is. And she's been left by her mother and is alone. There's a reference to Caesar. Caesar is a new addition to the plantation. He was raised as a slave with his parents on a small farm in Virginia and was always promised that once his owner died, he'd be set free. She did not leave any notes to that effect, and he was sold down south when she dies. And the further you get down south, the worse the slave system gets. So now he's in Georgia, in the plantation owned by James and Terrence Randall, two brothers. One more reference is to a kid named Chester. He's 10, and like Cora, is an orphan, and she's taking him under her wing. The music stopped, the circle broke. Sometimes a slave will be lost in a brief eddy of liberation, in the sway of a sudden reverie among the furrows, or while untangling the mysteries of an early morning dream, in the middle of a song on a warm Sunday night. Then it comes always, the overseer's cry, the call to work, the shadow of the master, the reminder that she's only a human being for a tiny moment across the eternity of her servitude. The Randall brothers had emerged from the great house and were among them. The slaves stepped aside, making calculations of what distance represented the right proportion of fear and respect. Godfrey, James's houseboy, held up a lantern. According to old Jockey, James favored the mother, stout as a barrel and just as firm in countenance, and Terrence took after the father, tall and owl-faced, perpetually on the verge of swooping down on prey. In addition to the land, they inherited their father's tailor, who arrived once a month in his rickety carriage with his samples of linen and cotton. The brothers dressed alike when they were children and continued to do so into manhood. Their white trousers and shirts were as clean as the laundry girl's hands could make them, and the orange glow made the men look like ghosts emerging from the dark. Master James, Jockey said. His good hand gripped his chair as if to rise. Master Terrence. Terrence said, don't let us disturb you. My brother and I were discussing business and heard the music. I told him, now that is the most god-awful racket I've ever heard. The Randalls were drinking wine out of goblets of cut glass and looked as if they drained a few bottles. Cora searched for Caesar's face in the crowd. She didn't find him. He hadn't been present the last time the brothers appeared together on the northern half. You did well to remember the different lessons of those occasions. Something always happened when the Randalls ventured into the quarter, sooner or later, a new thing coming that you couldn't predict until it was upon you. James left the daily operations to his man Connolly and rarely visited. He might grant a tour to a visitor, a distinguished neighbor or curious planter from another neck of the woods, but it was rare. James rarely addressed his niggers, who'd been taught by the lash to keep working and ignore his presence. When Terrence appeared in his brother's half of the plantation, he usually appraised each slave and made a note of which men were the most able and which women the most appealing. Content to leer at his brother's women, he grazed heartily upon the women of his own half. I like to taste my plums, Terence said, prowling the rows of cabins to see what struck his fancy. He violated the bonds of affection, sometimes visiting slaves on their wedding night to show the husband the proper way to discharge his marital duty. He tasted his plums and broke the skin and left his mark. It was accepted that James was of a different orientation. To hear his valet prideful tell it, James confined his erotic energies to specialized rooms in a New Orleans establishment. The madam was broad-minded and modern, adept in the trajectories of human desire. Prideful's stories were hard to believe, despite assurances that he received his reports from the staff of the place, with whom he'd grown close over the years. After all, what kind of white man would willingly submit to the whip? Terence scratched his cane in the dirt. It'd been his father's cane, topped with a silver wolf's head. Many remembered its bite on their flesh. Terence said, then I recollected James telling me about a nigger he had down here, could recite the Declaration of Independence. I can't bring myself to believe him. I thought perhaps tonight he can show me, since everyone is out and about from the sound of it. James said, we'll settle it. Where is that boy, Michael? No one said anything. Godfrey waved the lantern around pathetically. Moses was the boss, unfortunate enough to stand closest to the Randall brothers. He cleared his throat. Michael dead, Master James. Michael, the slave in question, had indeed possessed the ability to recite long passages. According to Connolly, who heard the story from the nigger trader, Michael's former master was fascinated by the abilities of South American parrots and reasoned that if a bird could be taught limericks, a slave might be taught to remember as well. Merely glancing at the size of their skulls told you that a nigger possessed a bigger brain than a bird. Michael had been the son of his master's coachman, had a brand of animal cleverness, the kind you see in pigs sometimes. The master and his unlikely pupil starred with simple rhymes and short passages from popular British versifiers. They went slow over the words the nigger didn't understand, and if truth be told, the master only half understood. But they made miracles, the tobacco farmer and the coachman's son. The Declaration of Independence was their masterpiece. Michael's ability never amounted to more than a parlor trick, delighting visitors before the discussion turned, as it always did, to the diminished faculties of niggers. His owner grew bored and sold the boy south. By the time Michael got to Randall, some torture or punishment had addled his senses. He was a mediocre worker. He complained of noises and black spells that blotted his memory. In exasperation, Connolly beat out what little brains he had left. It was a scourging that Michael was not intended to survive and had achieved its purpose. I should have been told, James said, his displeasure plain. Michael's recitation had been a novel diversion the two times he trotted the nigger out for guests. Terence liked to tease his brother. James, he said, you need to keep better account of your property. Don't meddle. Terence continued, I knew you let your slaves have revels, but I had no idea they were so extravagant. Are you trying to make me look bad? Don't pretend you care what a nigger thinks about you, Terence, James said. His glass was empty. He turned to go. Terence said, oh, one more song, James. These sounds have grown on me. George and Wesley, the musicians, were forlorn. Noble and his tambourine were nowhere to be seen. James pressed his lips into a slit. He gestured, and the men started playing. Terence tapped his cane. His face sank as he took in the crowd. You're not gonna dance? I have to insist. You and you and you. They didn't wait for their master's signal. The slaves of the northern half converged on the alley, haltingly, trying to insinuate themselves into their previous rhythm and put on a show. Putting on a show for master was a familiar skill, the small angles and advantages of the mask, and they shook off their fear as they settled into their performance. Oh, how they capered and hollered, shouted and hopped. Certainly this was the most lively song they'd ever heard, the musicians, the most accomplished players the colored race had to offer. Cora dragged herself into the circle, checking the Randall brothers' reactions on every turn like everyone else. Jockey tumbled his hands in his lap to keep time. Cora found Caesar's face. He stood in the shadow of the kitchen, his expression flat. Then he withdrew. You! It was Terence. He held his hand before him as if it were covered in some eternal stain that only he could see. Then Cora caught sight of it, the single drop of red wine staining the cuff of his lovely white shirt. Chester, the boy, had bumped him. Chester simpered and bowed before the white man. Sorry, master, sorry, master. The cane crashed across his shoulder and head again and again. The boy screamed and shrank to the dirt as the blows continued. Terence's arm rose and fell. James looked tired. One drop. A feeling settled over Cora. She had been under its spell in years since she brought the hatchet down on Blake's doghouse and sent the splinters into the air. She'd seen men hung from trees and left for buzzards and crows, women carved open to the bones with the cat o' nine tails, feet cut off to prevent escape and hands cut off to stop theft. She'd seen boys and girls younger than this beaten and had done nothing. This night, the feeling settled over her heart again. It grabbed hold of her, and before the slave part of her caught up with the human part of her, she bent over the boy's body as a shield. She held the cane in her hand like a swamp man handling a snake and saw the ornament at its tip. The silver wolf bared its silver teeth. Then the cane was out of her hand. It came down her head. It crashed down again, and this time the silver teeth ripped across her eyes and her blood splattered the dirt. So after that, things become untenable for Cora on the plantation. And she runs away north with Caesar, and they have many weird adventures, misadventures. She finds herself in one of the sort of alternative states. She finds herself in Indiana, where on a farm owned by free black people, runaways, people have come there for shelter and have their own community. It's separate from the rest of Indiana. They're self-sufficient, and every Friday they have dances and they debate the issues of the day. And in this brief section I'll close on, a conservative voice who's not sure what's next for black Americans has given his sort of speech. And now someone else, a more progressive, more visionary type named Lander, is giving his idea of what is next for the African American race and the country. Brother Mingo made some good points, Lander said. We can't save everyone, but that doesn't mean we can't try. Sometimes a useful delusion is better than a useless truth. Here's one delusion, that we can escape slavery. We can't. Its scars will never fade. When you saw your mother sold off, your father beaten, your sister abused by some boss or master, did you ever think that you'd sit here today without chains, without the yoke, among a new family? Everything you ever knew told you that freedom was a trick, and yet here you are. Still we run, tracking by the good full moon to sanctuary. Valentine Farm, this place, is a delusion. Who told you that the Negro deserved a place of refuge? Who told you that you had that right? Every minute of your life's suffering has argued otherwise. By every fact of history, it can exist. This place must be a delusion too. Yet here we are. And America too is a delusion, the grandest one of all. The white race believes with all its heart that it is their right to take the land, to kill Indians, make war, enslave their brothers. This nation shouldn't exist if there's any justice in the world, for its foundations are murder, theft, and cruelty. Yet here we are. I'm supposed to answer Mingo's call for gradual progress, for closing our doors to those in need. I'm supposed to answer those who think this place is too close to the grievous influence of slavery and that we should move west. I don't have an answer for you. I don't know what we should do. The word we In some ways, the only thing we have in common is the color of our skin. Our ancestors came from all over the African continent. It's quite large. Brother Valentine has the maps of the world in his splendid library. You can check for yourself. They had different ways of subsistence, different customs, spoke 100 different languages. And that great mixture was brought to America in the holds of slave ships. To the north, to the south, their sons and daughters picked tobacco, cultivated cotton, worked on the largest estates and the smallest farms. We are craftsmen and midwives and preachers and peddlers. Black hands built the White House, the seat of our nation's government. The word we. We are not one people, but many people. How can one person speak for this great, beautiful race, which is not one race, but many, with a million desires and hopes and wishes for ourselves and our children? For we are Africans in America, something new in the history of the world, without models for what we will become. Color must suffice. It's brought us here to this night, this discussion, and it will take us into the future. All I truly know is that we rise and fall as one colored family living next door to one white family. We may not know the way through the forest, but we can pick each other up when we fall, and we will arrive together. Thank you. So if you have any questions or tips, happy to hear some tips, always.
Actually, my voice carries, I think.
Well, just for the
okay.
People.
Okay, okay, there we go. Hi, my name is Tamara, and I so enjoyed the book. And as you stated, Cora is a young teenager when the book begins, but she's just a young adult woman when the story ends. And I got the distinct impression that she has more life to live in the pages. So will there be a part two?
I guess if you haven't read the book, she doesn't die horribly in the last few pages. Well, there's no flashback to her early life. I think her story is done. You know, I think back to those last 10 pages, and I think I put her in a place that makes sense to everything that's happened to her in terms of how the world works and her psychology. Some people have asked me to, like, you know, break the ending down further, and I think, you know, there's one sort of basic thing is that it's 1850. That's sort of my ballpark year for the book. And even if she went to San Francisco and won a lottery and won $3 million, she's still a black woman in a very racist country. So she's not on the plantation, and she, you know, I'm not going to say where she ends up, but she has experienced different ideas of what freedom is. But the fact is that it's still 1850. So, but the story is done, and thanks so much for reading.
Yes, this is a devastating book for white Southerner to read. And it ends on a hopeful note, I think, with the trip west. If you wrote it again today, would it still have that hopeful note?
I'm very happy with the ending. And I think after all she's been through, I think she's sort of earned that, you know, the place where she ends up without getting too specific. I know that it's, you know, it is hard to read. It's hard if you're a white person descended from people who owned slaves to realize what was required on a daily basis to keep human beings in their place and reckon with the rape, torture, punishment, and murder that was required to keep the system in place. If you're African American, third generation college, has seen, you know, had a bit of the American dream, have lived to see the strange miracle of the first black president. How do you reckon with the devastation and humiliation of your ancestors who died namelessly in the void of slavery? I can trace some of my family to Virginia. The other half lived and died in Georgia, Florida, Alabama. I don't know. I'll never know their names. So how do we reckon, just as Americans, with our shared past? You know, in the book, I try to figure out from a 2015 perspective how to write about slavery. And so there are evil slave masters, there are heroic white abolitionists, there are evil slaves, there are heroic slaves. And that's really that sort of the big chorus of humanity. No one is truly at their best self when you're in a place where human chattel slavery exists. So anyway, thanks for the question.
I have less a question than an observation. I've practiced law for 40 years, so it might be that shortcoming that brings me to this observation. I forgot what page it is, but there's a point in the book where they're in Indiana.
Okay.
And Georgina is teaching the Declaration of Independence, teaching young children to memorize it. And she says, what they don't understand today, they might tomorrow. And then she says, and this is the quote that I was taken with, the Declaration is like a map. You trust that it's right, but you only know by going out and testing it yourself. And I really was taken with that, taken to the point that I posted it on a Facebook account, and I said, this is really a real and kind of deep commentary. Someone wrote back and said, Jim, your posts are always somewhat more elevated than most others. Nice quote.
Okay.
So, I'm happy to ride your coattails.
I am honored that I made it to your page. Thank you.
Oh, hi. You talked about how difficult it was for people to read the book. I'm interested in knowing how hard it was to write. You had to dwell in a very difficult place for a long time.
Well, for me, the hard part was doing the research and coming to the material as a grown-up. You know, I was 8 when Roots was on and the whole family gathered around and that was my first acquaintance. I studied history in college, but coming, doing this deep dive into slave narratives and histories of slavery, as a grown-up with children and imagining what it would be like for my kids to see me whipped, vice versa, abused in various ways, sold off, I had a more grown-up reckoning with it. And so realizing just to be realistic, what I had to put my characters through was devastating. And then also realizing that what I'm putting on the page is only a fraction of what it was actually like for people who went through it. So there's that kind of double reckoning. So once I started writing, I found a good instrument in the narrative voice, where it's close enough with the characters, hopefully, but also a part that I'm shaping the material artistically, and it's not just throwing it on a page. And so the narrator's close and far, and a lot of that tone comes from slave narratives. They're describing the atrocities of their childhood from 40 years removed, and they'll describe the most horrible things with the most matter-of-fact voice and intonation, word choice. And it seemed that that was how the slaves described the torments of their youth, and it seemed a good instrument for the narrator. And once I started writing, I was fine. My office is in the basement, so I just work down there, and at 3 p.m. I'm like, well, I've got to make dinner for the family, and it's all very separate. I come up and go to times.com and find a recipe, and it's very separate. So I'm off work at 3. I'm not up all night tossing and turning. My one moment of fear or horror was when I got 100 pages in, and I thought it was okay. I can watch 12 Years a Slave. I'd never seen it, but I was like, I won't get infected now because the book's already going, and I can see other things. And I couldn't finish it. I could put it on the page, but I couldn't actually see actors going through the events that I was dealing with every day. And I still haven't finished it, the movie since then. So I can have an intellectual relationship to it, but I have this real revulsion to actually seeing it on screen and vivid in that way. Thanks.
Thank you for bringing up 12 Years a Slave. I saw it in Atlanta, a place that Michael Shea calls the blackest city in America. Unfortunately, they lost the Super Bowl to the most racist city in America.
Sure, yes.
I'm what's called a bitter Southerner. I own my past. I don't deny the evil that was done and the damage that it did not only to black folk, but to the slave owners. They were morally just destroyed by it. Dr. King was a wonderful, recognized that in wonderful ways. I founded this festival, and one of the things we emphasized was not doing literary readings as you've done tonight, but you did it in context of your how you became a person capable of writing the book you wrote, and it resonated with me. The slogan of the festival today is "Lose yourself in books." I've lived my whole life finding myself in books. I've read James Cone and those people. I'm curious, one passage in the book, we all work for Eli Whitney. The blacksmith and the...
Yeah,
exactly. And I'm curious as to what role Savannah played in your research.
Yeah,
slave auction ever.
The book starts in Georgia before it departs in these different sort of alternative states. And really, it was just sort of arbitrary. It could have started in Florida or North Carolina. I really started wanting her to go north for a while and then turn left. Because it's all the states are alternative states of America, taking off from real things, imagined things. North Carolina is an alternative North Carolina. Georgia is an alternative Georgia. So for me, all the state names are really sort of placeholder names. She could have started in Florida instead of Georgia, et cetera. Most of my research was reading, the primary documents through the public domain, so I don't have to leave the house. Just put in my iPad, which is nice. My one sort of field research was to New Orleans to see some plantations, and so I got on the tour bus, the only black tourist on the bus, and the driver, the little tour guide, we're going out on the River Road North, and she's like, slavery wasn't all mint juleps. You had to keep track of the accounts and the workers. So immediately, because I wasn't getting I was getting one version, and with the two plantations, one is the Whitney Plantation, which is actually a museum devoted to slavery, and it's great, and you should go. And the other is the Oak Alley Plantation, where they film a lot of movies, and it's from the slave master's point of view. And if you go on their website, you can have, you can rent it out for an authentic antebellum wedding. You can just get all ginned up in the costumes, and they have hotel rooms you can rent, and so it says on the website, if you want to break free from hotel chains, stay in our... And at that point, I was written two-thirds of the book, so just the weird postmodern ironies of race in America were like small potatoes to actually writing about it every day. So Georgia's in there in the same way that North Carolina is and is not in there. So maybe last question or...
I had to read very carefully because between my naivety, unfortunately, and your extraordinary use of metaphors, I often found myself not being sure what I was reading. But so I'll just ask you, was Ridgway a metaphor for something? Because I remember how shocked and scared I was when he reappeared to Cora.
Okay, yeah, well, without spoilers, but so Ridgway...
Sorry about that. I just assumed we had all read the book. I'm sorry.
Ridgway is a very dogged slave catcher who pursues Cora for a long time, so he does reappear a couple times. I wanted a formidable villain to stand up to Cora, and hopefully that's Ridgway. He's a representative of an American philosophy of imperialism, manifest destiny, white supremacy, and you know, when she gets to, when they get to Tennessee and it's Cora and Ridgway, for me, Tennessee is really just the stage for them to battle and have philosophical arguments about who they are and what America is. So, you know, as a larger-than-life figure, you know, he does have allegorical flourishes. Hopefully, in his weird moments of charmingness, which I find him charming some, or charismatic in some ways, even in his complete evil. Hopefully, you know, even the best villains, you can see yourself in them and sometimes in their weakness and sometimes in their brief moments of grace. And so, but basically, I just wanted a villain who could stand up to Cora. So thank you so much for having me. I hope you enjoy the rest of the festival.